power and potential, power, and having the confidence and the commitment to struggle in order to make those that potential reality, in fact, a reality. It is, in fact, putting the people and the planet and peace over profit. It's understanding that, you know, if we're going to be fully human beings, we've got to transcend this narrow, backward, vicious capitalist system. That's difficult for many of us to come to terms with and accept, and that's all right. But for those of us who can see it now and are prepared to struggle for that new reality, I say stick in, struggle, ground yourself, and understand that you are, in fact, on the right side of history. And in that struggle, as long as I'm here, I'm going to be with you. Thank you. So, I'm going to go to Q&A. I did talk longer than I wanted to.
All right. So I have a lot of questions. I'm going to start at where you started. So you define your human rights as a right to food, water, shelter, money, right? Is that in the context of her human rights, or is it something that's in the way?
No, it's right now the emphasis in the mainstream human rights movement is primarily the civil and political rights. We've got a number of groups that have focused in on economic, social, and cultural rights, food, housing, healthcare, public transportation. What we're saying is, yes, those are human rights also. But we're saying that our analysis suggests to us that we're not going to be able to realize those individual and collective human rights within the system. But we say that we recognize those human rights reflected in the major human rights instruments, which serve as the foundation for the human rights framework, but that we have a right ourselves as people engaged in struggle to determine what that language means, in essence, in those documents. That basically, if we say we have a right to housing, what does that really mean? Well, for some of us, it means we have to decommodify housing. It means that basically we take housing off the table as a commodity, that the people collectively own the land, that you don't have to be using half of your income just to pay rent in order to have a roof over your head. We say that in education, it means that we have a society that's committed to human rights, education as human rights. It means that we all have a chance to fully develop our human capacity by going to school. And that happened, that worrying about having to pay for it. And that coming out at the end of the process with $80,000, $120,000 in debt. We say that education should be free. That, you know, as a collective society and a state that really belongs to us, we would use our resources to make sure that we have free education. It says that, you know, if we're going to have people who have work, if we have women who are the heads of households, that we should have universal child care that's free. It says that we need to have public transportation that's accessible and developed. Because without public transportation, it's very difficult to realize some of your other human rights, like the right to health care and education, and the right to a job, because if you can't get there, you can't get to your job, you can't get to the hospital, you can't realize those human rights. So we say that basically that kind of commitment to human rights suggests a different kind of configuration in terms of how the government is organized and what kind of interests are serviced. The only way that those kinds of rights can be realized, in my estimation, is we have a different kind of system, a system that many of us call social.
Right. I think the language they're using is mean free as in, is this free or free as in providing for you?
Free as in free.
Yes, well, nothing is inherent free.
We're free in the sense that basically what we do as a collective society is determine that the resources we generate in our society will be used to address our human needs. And so instead of us spending $712 billion on the military, putting money in the pockets of these gangsters, the criminals, who are head of these defensive companies, we say that those kinds of resources can be used to provide universal health care, universal child care, free education. That's what we say. And basically, we have the resources. Right now, the resources are not being used in the interest of the people. They're being stolen from us by this oligarchy that convinces us that this is the only way society is organized, and that this, in fact, is rational. And that human beings are the best kind of human beings in this kind of backward and irrational system. We say no. We say the human beings are more than this. That society can be reorganized in a way in which all of us can be better human beings once we get control of our own resources and our own production processes, where that production is not for profit, but for human needs. Now, I'm going to have to come back to you. I want you to have too many questions. We'll come back to you.
Yes. Yes. What's the end of your speech in reference to 1984 and also since that was a book of some totalitarianism? You also, at least you're skeptical of the current administration. But then you advocated for improving the wage for guys who are involved in the wage, something like that. I'm sure it's require massive expansions of the government. That would probably also massively increase the risk of a totalitarian regime taking over. How do you reconcile that?
Well, I think for me, and how one defines totalitarianism, some people argue, people like Herbert Marcuse, argues that we have a capitalist totalitarian system right now, that is controlled by capitalism. That basically we have the illusion that we have a choice, but it's all the same kinds of products, but you have different kinds of labels. That basically our ideals in terms of how we see ourselves as human beings are ideals that have been sort of imposed on us, penetrated our consciousness to make us believe that this kind of system is in fact wrong. And that any other way of organizing, including having a state that belongs to us, that reallocates resources based on our needs, that in some way is in fact irrational and could result in us being controlled by that state. Now, you know, for me, the issue is always the question of whose state are we talking about? Are we talking about a state that belongs to us, that reflects our interests, that we control through democratic means? Or are we talking about a state like what we have right now, in which there is no real democracy, this democracy for the corporations and for the ruling elite, for the 1%? But all we get a chance to do is to go every 2 or 4 years into a voting booth and determine what set of oppressors are going to be in office for the next 2 or 4 years. That, to us, is not democracy. Democracy is when you have the ability to determine all aspects of your life, including what kinds of products get produced, whether that a company can relocate from your community. That's real democracy. And if you have real democracy, then your state apparatus that you control is your state. Right now, the state that's in place is not our state. It's the state of the 1%. It's the state of the oligarchy, including its two political parties. and including his ability to control ideas so that even imagining something different from this becomes almost unimaginable. Follow up.
Yes, isn't that just the tyranny of authority to roles deciding to be there, you know? That kind of system is what has led to Venezuela being in the conditions that they are today. You know, it started out as this grand socialist movement that was going to take the land, bring back the people, the corporations there, and we've seen what it's evolved into. So, I mean, if you are going to, it seems like you're advocating for more direct democracy, voting on the issues themselves as they come. If you're going to have that, what checks and balances are you going to have to keep the majority of people from harming the minority?
Well, that's a good question. And that was a concern that was at the center of the so-called founding fathers. They're concerned about majority rule and making sure that they had safeguards for minority rights. That's what you see all throughout the federalist papers, that concern. And that's why they set up an anti-democratic republic. You see, I believe in democracy. I don't believe that there's real dangers in a fully informed, rational majority of people informed by the highest ethical principles becoming necessarily oppressive. I'm not that concerned about the rights of minorities, that minority might be a ruling class 1% that has the ability to oppress and exploit the rest of us. A 1% of which we see that 0.1% has the wealth, the equivalent of the rest of the 93% of the population. That to me is unsustainable and is immoral. So any arguments, in my opinion, that attempt to suggest that that is a rational way in which we should organize society and allocate resources, I think that's a tall order for me. The possibility of experimenting with organizing society, organizing production in a different way, makes more sense than accepting that this obscenity that we have with the CEOs are making 352 times more than the average worker. I mean, that to me is unjustifiable. So, what we have in places like Venezuela, that's being framed is like the inevitable logical outcome that we try to organize and build socialism. On one level, my friends, it's all BS. Because basically, the part of the story that people don't talk about is the systematic undermining of that economy, the destabilization of it by the Obama administration in cahoots with the oligarchy in Venezuela, creating the conditions that we see today. And what happens is, when you create those conditions, then the corporate media points to that and says, oh, look at those poor people in Venezuela. Look how they screwed up their economy. Look at what socialism does. No. Socialism hasn't really had a chance to really develop itself because it's always within the context of massive attempts to undermine it. It ends up even distorting some of the experiments. So no, we understand. We understand the game. We understand the terms of the ideological struggle. And all I'm saying is that, I think people are getting to a point now where fewer and fewer people are falling for it. And that's why the corporations had to bury information. That's why Google had to change its algorithms so that all the young folks who are now researching on socialism, asking questions about alternatives, now it becomes more difficult. 2 months ago, all of our sites, all of us who write for alternative media, there was this drastic reduction in traffic going to our sites because group decided that basically they know better than the rest of us what kind of information people should have access to. We were told at one point that the way your stuff comes up on Google is as a consequence of how many people go to your sites, right? You know, how many people, you know, get your information. So as a consequence of people going to our sites, you know, we all have risen, you know? So they had to go in and alter that because from their point of view, that information is not legitimate. They have determined that that kind of alternative information that critiques and criticizes capitalism is too dangerous for you all to have access to. If that's not the beginning of totalitarianism, then maybe I don't know what that is.
What do you think right now is like the state of the left, like labor movements in America? Like you see like the past progression of all major political parties, especially with like our generation, like the rise of movements like Democratic Socialists and the popularity of candidates like Bernie Sanders. Do you think these are positive developments or more just like a smokescreen for like become reforms at all to be like progressive?
Well, you know, that's a good question. I think that the latter part of your question, I think that any of these developments that have a progressive character, including the expansion of TSA, it's all right with me. Because I think that they're not going to get stuck at the level of just reformism because of the internal logic of what we're dealing with, that reformism is no longer possible. So if they have the sort of value perspective, concerns, commitment to radical politics, then I think that they are on the right track now. And so I would encourage that even some of the issues with Bernie Sanders, you know, I think you know the Sanders phenomenon has been useful in raising questions, introducing concepts like the 1%. I wish you had a more developed class framework, but you know, I take this for now. But Bernie has some issues. Because Bernie is also, because Bernie's representing those, something we have to really deal with, and that is this U.S. centrism. This notion that you can be progressive or radical in the U.S. And be concerned about domestic policy, but yet still be supportive of U.S. imperialism. That's a contradiction. But, you know, we take it for now, but we go further. And many of you all know, both of us in another party, you know, we have a platform we committed to anti-imperialism, peace. And we say you can't be a radical, you can't be a progressive in this country and support U.S. aggression and U.S. imperialism. This can't be. We'll come back to you. Someone has spoken.
One thing I haven't heard you talk about tonight, and would you please talk about the connection between this militarism, the imperialism I've heard you talk about, capitalism, which I've heard you talk about, and how that those two things relate to the looming environmental catastrophe that is on the horizon. How do those three things, can you describe the relationship between those three things?
Well, that's an interesting question. I think that the climate contradiction, the climate crisis we are facing, many people argue it's not really an issue of climate change, for example, but the consequence of capitalist production. That basically when you have capitalist industrial processes that have resulted in the pollution of the climate, then what we see is the consequence of that. And the climate in society is going to be warmer, so that's a consequence of human activity. And that human activity has primarily been activity that had any respect for nature, any respect for the earth. So one of the results of us having a more rational economic and political system is that we'll be able to address in a more rational way how we produce. And we can begin to, and we are developing ways in which we can produce that's more in harmony with the planet, more harmony with the planet. And that's the only way we're going to be able to address this climate crisis. Unless we are able to, in fact, do that, many people are making an argument that we are, in fact, facing real issues of existential challenge. That basically, unless we're able to decommodify water, allocate resources in a more rational way, actually really have real policies to reduce carbon emissions, that we are on a path toward collective destruction. So for me, that suggests that the traditional sort of contradictory relationship between, say, workers and capitalists, where the agents of change was the working class, that suggests to me that the agents of change go beyond now just the working class. The contradictions now between, in my opinion, all of humanity collectively and that small capitalist minority that's upholding this backward system. So that's how we have to get to this, to these issues. The keys are coming back to me for radical and fundamental revolutionary change. Come a year and we come back to you.
So I figure you may have heard this kind of thing before, but what would you say to the idea that, you know, suggesting universal healthcare, universal education, universal housing, what that does to kind of the inherent reward system that we have set up within ourselves? Because we kind of work to be, to have those things as it is. So if we do not have to work to have those things, what does that do in terms of production, you know? And is that even a problem? Or is it, if we end up kind of having a base for everyone to start off on, which is kind of the suggestion I'm making, it doesn't really, I think, solve the problem of inequality, because, I mean, at the end of the day, we still be working to get ahead of the next person. And then it's still be that issue of maybe that's just how we think ideologically. But say we have a flat out house where everyone lives in that just has like one bathroom or something. They're still going to walk for the obscene four house, five bathroom type of thing. And does it really solve anything at the end of the day to have a universal system? And what does that do for the reward system and the level of production that we can go in, because we work so that they can be the CEO that isn't doing anything that has bad action?
Good question. You know, one thing about what we are advocating for is that when we talk about radical change, we're talking about the concept of social revolution. And what that means is fundamental change in every aspect of society, including consciousness, including our value system. You see, I don't believe that people produce just as a consequence of so-called rewards. I don't believe, and I don't see the evidence that supports this, that human beings are naturally competitive. I don't believe that without material incentives, people won't produce. I think, and for example, people like Che Guevara believe that you can organize socialism and that the incentive is service to humanity, service to your community, service to your fellow person. Now, of course, for many people that sounds sort of pie in the sky naive, you know, and perhaps maybe it is. I believe it's real possible. You see, if you look at how human beings evolved, this notion of a state of nature that came out of the twisted minds of people like Thomas Hobbes and those folks, you know, it never existed. You know, that was a particular kind of view of human beings that had an ideological objective, and that was to justify the reorganization of society to allow this new class that was developing to justify it. But if you look at how people really evolve, we evolve collectively. We are social beings. If we didn't have social inclinations, if we didn't engage in collective production processes, we wouldn't have survived as a species. You see, if we were naturally competitive, if that was part of our human makeup, then doesn't logic suggest that you see that kind of behavior in every society? Right? If people are naturally competitive, naturally aggressive, then that's natural. You take a dog and isolate that dog from any all other dogs, put them out in the woods, and that dog's gonna bark because it's a natural phenomenon. Okay? If you find human beings or human societies that organize themselves and function differently, function in collective ways, then that suggests then that the notion of us being naturally one way is questionable. I believe that, you know, we can be more than this. And I think that the only way we're going to be able to address these issues of climate change, these issues of the finite resources on this planet, is we've got to have different kind of ways in which we organize society. Because folks, there's going to be 9 billion people on this planet pretty soon, right? And if we continue the way we are now, we're not going to survive. It makes no sense for us to have billions of people on this planet and a tiny percentage of the population being able to control all of these resources and wealth. That's irrational. The fact that people don't have access to clean water. That companies claim water as a commodity. You can produce any water. That we believe that you have a right to the minerals in Mother Earth because you have capital. It's really kind of irrational, but we have been taught to believe that that in fact is rational because it's reflective of a certain kind of value system. It says that basically if you have capital, you must be superior because you got capital. And therefore, you have a right to be able to, you have freedom to be able to exploit Mother Earth, to exploit other human beings, because that is the way things are. That basically people are naturally competitive. The best rise to the top, and if you don't rise to the top, it basically is a reflection of your own issues, your own deficiencies. All of that to me is ideological, is all BS. We'll come back to you. Go ahead. Slavery attacking there and stretch out to the exposure of the Well, I think that in terms of China, for example, there are many of us who are concerned about this distorted process in China. They call it the Chinese approach to socialism. But our understanding of socialism will apply to suggest to us that we have situations where workers are basically exploited, don't have the ability to determine for themselves their own life processes, but that's not good socialism. So what we've seen is that some experiments that call themselves socialists have developed in ways that have been affecting the question. Part of the reason has been, again, always that these experiments take place within a global context. It's always external issues and pressure because, you know, some people argue, some theorists argue that you can't have socialism in one nation, that we have socialist development within the context of the world capitalist system, that you have inevitable distortions in terms of it. So, you know, and then in terms of the human rights question, I would have to kind of push back on that a little bit and suggest that we can always find human rights violators. And for me, as a human rights activist, I pursue the number one human rights violator on this planet as the United States of America.
I think that is.
So basically, you know, I'm willing to go back in history. I want to go back and talk about the march of the colonists from the East Coast of the U.S. across this landmass we call the United States of America. I want to deal with that. I know part of that history. I would just say, if you just look at the post-Second World War period, where the U.S. has been involved in the systematic destruction of attacks on peoples and nations around the planet. That when the defeated European powers, the colonial powers that came out of the Second World War, in essence defeated, they attached themselves to the U.S. while they tried to reclaim their colonies, French, British, around the globe, with the support of the U.S., resulting in massive loss of life. Because these Europeans were not prepared to surrender their control and their hegemony over peoples and resources that they exploited for centuries that created Europe. And they did that with the full support of the U.S. The U.S. itself has been involved in attacking, undermining societies and states in every part of the planet. All of the most horrendous crimes in my opinion, since 1945, the U.S. committed the symptom of it. From overthrowing governments, slaughtering in Indonesia, the Vietnam conflict in Korea, DRC, you name it, and the U.S. is right there in the middle of the Contra wars, the assassinations, and now in the last 16 years, this obscene criminal behavior by the U.S. in the so-called Middle East has resulted in the destruction of Iran, Afghanistan, Libya, Syria, bombings in Somalia, destabilization in Kenya, war now that they allow their barbaric allies to involve themselves in Yemen, the undermining of democracy in Honduras, propping up dictatorships in Haiti, supporting apartheid in South Africa for decades. And when you talk about the propping up and support of the Southern Colonial State of Israel. So no, my friend, I think that for me, the number one violator of human rights on this planet, and in fact, the number one enemy of humanity on this planet is the United States of America, under both Democrats and Republicans.
I'm looking for me to write.
my issue with Syria is not so much any person, Assad or anybody else. My issue with Syria was the right of the Syrian people to determine for themselves their destiny. And so any external intervention on the part of any state into that situation, uninvited to me, is a violation of international law. And it should be questioned in their homes. So, you know, try to make me an Assad apologist or a Putin apologist, I got a record, and I think that didn't really hold up. That basically for me, I couldn't care about Assad or Putin or anybody else. I stand as human rights defender, I stand with people. So I have a position on Assad. I'm clear about Assad. I know in terms of issues with the authentic left in Syria. I have friends who are part of the authentic left in Syria. Many of those elements, though, were opposed to the interventions on the part of the gangsters that are aligned with the U.S., you know, the Saudis and Qatar and Turkey. They were opposed to their country being mashed up by these external forces.